Good evening and good day to everyone. We are very happy that you've joined us. Welcome to our webinar today, which will focus on vaccines, on coronavirus vaccines primarily. This epidemic that is isolated and caused so much separation between us has yet also brought about the very opposite. This epidemic has created these virtual communities, which today we are very happy to be here together. Host you all here tonight, and thank you very much to our relationship and community relationship team, Francine and others who organized this activity. Today's session has three parts. We will start off by short 5-minute lectures by our speakers, whom I will soon introduce. We will then move on to a group discussion focusing on a number of topics around vaccinations, topics which we received via email. The last and the third part will be open to all of you to send us our questions on the chat, and we will do our best to respond to these questions. So without further ado, I would like to introduce our first speaker, Professor Dana Wolf. Dana is a professor of virology and infectious diseases at the Hebrew University of Jerusalem and a senior infectious diseases physician at the Hadassah University Hospital, so closely affiliated with us. Dana will offer us a short, I would call it virology 101 course, to provide the background and the fundamentals which will assist us as we continue our discussions. So Dana, please.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here today with you. I will share my very short presentation. Can you see it?
Yes, we can see it.
Okay. So I chose to entitle my presentation, Our Wit versus Their Gene. Or maybe I should modify for today's topic, Our Wisdom Using Their Genes Against Them. So let's see. So in recent years, following the sequence of emerging infections or pandemics, we have been almost bombarded by pandemics. So, well, just looking just in the last decade, starting with swine influenza virus, who remembers it anymore? It became the seasonal influenza. And then moving forward to MERS coronavirus, Middle East, the coronavirus of our region, transmitted from camels to humans, and associated with a high mortality rate, almost 30% mortality rate, luckily affecting only a few thousands of people globally so far. And then Ebola virus, and then Zika virus, tremendously affecting pregnant women and newborns, associated with devastating neurodevelopmental disabilities, again, affecting a few thousands of congenitally infected children so far. And then finally, now we are in the midst of the COVID-19 pandemic. So where do these pandemics come from and why are they mainly caused by viruses? Let me start with a basic, very basic question, virology 101, as you called it, Yishai. So what are viruses? By analogy with the computer viruses, most of you are aware of them, we can regard the biological viruses as a package of genetic code for orders, with giving orders, enclosed or packaged in a protein code. This is what viruses are. So viruses cannot replicate on their own. They are real parasites. They require living cells to replicate. They have like kind of a borrowed life, but they still control our cells completely when they gain access to our cells, as we all know by now. What is really very, very interesting about viruses, and then maybe may explain what we are seeing now, is their adaptive evolution. So here comes the expression, it's our wit versus their genes. They constantly adapt, they constantly mutate. And I think the term mutation is now familiar to everybody in the audience. So viruses mutate all the time. But sometimes a mutation confers a competitive advantage. And here you can see the sequence of events that associated with the emergence of the UK, recently emerging UK strain, something that the virus gains something that allows that version to outperform all the viruses around it. And here you can see the more detailed version of the mutation. Here is the UK version. Here is the South African version, and they mutate the mutants in the spike protein, the protein on the surface of the virus. They have some common mutation in the spike protein, some different one. Now, both UK and South African super strain, they became like super strain, have the same mutation, but each strain developed independently. So the virus has evolved in ways that make it more contagious. And we know that these strains are becoming now more contagious, at least 50% more contagious, more infectious than the previous strain. Now, we know that the virus is more contagious. We also believe that it's not associated so far with more severe disease. But the main question, which we may come back to later on during the discussion, will the mutation affect the capacity of the antibodies? Will the mutation affect the capacity of the antibodies to fight, to neutralize the virus? The antibodies that are formed either by natural infection from recovering individuals or the ones that are formed by the vaccine that we will talk about today. So I will leave this question open so far. Okay, now to the question of emerging, we can better address it. So the emerging transmission, and these pandemics are mainly transmitted from, acquired by animal or caused by animal to human transmission. And these pandemics are mainly transmitted from, acquired by animal or caused by animal to human transmission. Bats that apparently, I don't know how many people, how many of you are aware of it, of bats, they are migrate to human transmission. And who remembers this film? This is actually day one of a potential pandemic. Okay, another ecological niche is the wet market in China. And this is actually the niche that started the SARS-CoV-1 in 2003 and the SARS-CoV-2. But what makes this market special is that the animals have brought them alive, and I'm sorry, the vegetarians could not. But this is what meat industry or wet market can cause. So the viruses can be transmitted from live animals in the market and then from animals to humans. So I think, and this is bad news, but I'm sure that it's going to be true. So another pandemic is a matter of when and not if. Now the main, I would say what defines the fate of the pandemic will be the balance between these parameters, transmissibility versus virulence versus mortality. So the SARS-CoV-2, the COVID-19 is highly transmissible, but the mortality is relatively low, 1%. But imagine what happens if we have a very successful transmissible virus with a high mortality rate, like the MERS or like the Nipah virus. And finally, I think that we need to prepare. There is an ongoing need to prepare. So here is our translational goals, and maybe in Shai we can come to more examples later, but we need ongoing monitoring of viral infection. We need to develop high throughput and rapid diagnostics to be prepared. We need better understanding of mechanisms of virus transmission and pathogenesis, and not just viruses, but their interaction with the host. Virus-host interaction is now in the center of virology research, and our natural defense. Once we understand these features, we can develop vaccines and antivirals. And with this, I will now stop.
Thank you so much, Dana. This was a very enticing, beginning. It is now my pleasure to invite Professor Amos Panet. So Amos is from the Department of Biochemistry and Molecular Biology in Imrik at the Hebrew University. Amos will talk about vaccines, focusing on the current platforms we have, as well as some being proposed against the coronavirus. And I hope we may also hear a little, Amos, about the up-and-coming Israeli vaccine. So please.
Can I have the slides? Okay. Good evening to all of you, or good day to those in the United States. My name is Amos Panet, And I will show you just two slides. The first slide relates to the different platforms for developing vaccines. As you know, we have been developing vaccines since the early 50s with the development of the first vaccine, which is a polio vaccine by Salk and then by Sabin in the United States. And these vaccines, these early vaccines, were developed by growing the virus, the pathogenic virus, and then after purifying the virus, by killing the virus such that it will retain the structure of a virus, but will lose its pathogenic activity. And this is the basis of all the early vaccines. Later on, other investigators like Sabin and others developed viruses which are live viruses, but they're attenuated, meaning that they can infect the person, but they cannot cause a disease. Thus, the immune system will be immunized and get on to give us defense against infections. So attenuated virus as a second platform to develop vaccines. And many of the diseases which you know, like child diseases, like measles, are based on attenuated virus that are infectable, but they are not pathogenic. The third platform to develop vaccine is to grow the virus and to purify a certain protein of the virus, which is important for the immunogenicity, for developing antibodies in the person who gets the shot. So the flu virus contains part of the virus, it's a protein, and we inject the protein to the muscle, like we inject now the RNA vaccine to the muscle, and the protein then induced the immune system against further infection with pathogenic influenza virus. Then we come to a more elaborate and a modern vaccine development. Previous slide, please. And this is a developing a vector which is similar to an attenuated virus, but we can engineer into this virus a gene like the coronavirus gene, and then inject this virus to a person and get immunization, because this virus, which is attenuated virus, it doesn't cause a disease, will produce now the COVID-19 protein and induce the immune system. Like this type of vaccines have been prepared by AstraZeneca and Oxford, and the Sputnik, the Russian vaccine, is also based on this platform, and the Biological Institute in Es Ziona in Israel is also based on an attenuated virus into which a coronavirus protein or information has been inserted. So we will see more and more of these vaccines in months to come. The end is just now with RNA vaccines, but actually there are many more vaccines based on all these platforms are based. Next slide, please. I would like now to show you how the Pfizer has shown that the vaccine, the RNA vaccine, which they developed, and Professor Soreq will speak about this vaccine later. What Pfizer has done, they have taken in the last phase of the development, they've taken 42,000 people and developed these 40,000 people into two groups, 21 in each group. One group, can I get it back? One group has gotten the vaccine, and one group has gotten what we call placebo. Placebo is just injection of nothing, of water, really. And so these people are not vaccinated, the placebo, 21,000 placebo people, and the vaccine people are vaccinated. And then I told the 42,000 people, go home, live your life, and if you are sick, come back to us and report with your problems, whether you have fever or you have a headache or you cough. And then out of the 42,000 people, some 170 people came back and reported that they have COVID-19. These people have been tested and validated. They indeed have the COVID vaccine. And then the Yishai.
I will share again the screen right now.
Yeah, please share. Thank you, Mark.
Once the study was opened up, it was found that about 160 people came with a disease from those who have injected with placebo, and only some 10, 20 people came with those who injected with the vaccine. From this, Pfizer has concluded that the vaccine is 95% efficient. I must say that this is an incredible study, and it shows so nicely the difference between the people who vaccinated with the RNA vaccine and those that were not vaccinated. So we have now a very effective vaccine, much more effective than the influenza vaccine that we get every year. And as Professor Soreq will tell you later, it's very safe vaccine, and we all take it. I've taken it. Thank you so much, Amos.
It is now my pleasure to introduce Professor Hermona, or Mona Soreq. So Mona holds the Hebrew University Schlesinger Chair in Molecular Neuroscience, is also a founding member of ELSEC, of our Edmund and Lily Safra Center for Brain Sciences. And Mona will talk about, I think, the big buzz in town, which is the mRNA-based vaccines. How does it work? Do you think it's dangerous? Could we grow horns if we take this vaccine? So please, Mona. So, we're waiting for the foils to come up, yeah?
Can you see it?
No, we don't yet see foils. Okay. No, not yet.
Okay. So let me start the share screen altogether again. Okay.
Okay. Yeah, it's coming up, Mona. It's coming up. Here it is. We see it.
Okay. So thanks, Shai. And first, let me share with you my first experience ever of going to the basketball stadium in Jerusalem. I'm not a basketball fan, so I never had the opportunity to be there. But then I was invited there to get vaccinated. So it's a huge stadium, three floors. At each floor, there's another HMO. You show them your telephone with the invitation, hundreds of chairs and 9 simultaneous injection stands. And every minute someone else is called. After injection, we were asked to stay there for 20 minutes. And now we are expecting the second injection. It was amazingly well organized, and I'm really pleased to have been vaccinated. So what can I tell you about the coronavirus vaccine that you didn't hear yet from reading newspapers, chatting with your friends, and from these two lectures. So the first important thing is, in Israel, we are being vaccinated by an RNA vaccine of the coronavirus. And so this is the virus. Like every creature, it has RNA, and it affects a lot of tissues in our body, much more than the lung, which it infects initially. It can also affect other tissues and functions. Women are somewhat more protected against the viral infection than men, which is important to remember, but that doesn't mean that we shouldn't be careful. The virus lands on our cells through a protein, which was mentioned by the previous two speakers. And the whole idea of the vaccine is to target this particular protein, the spike protein. Now, if we think about gene expression, and that was my job to teach students at Hebrew University, what is gene expression all about? So we are talking about three steps: DNA in every cell of our body, RNA, which is transcribed from the DNA, and proteins that are translated from the RNA. And it goes like a pyramid. There is a small piece of DNA in every cell. It can be transcribed more than once. So we have an amplification at the level of the RNA. And the RNA can be translated many times also. So the pyramid grows consecutively. And then what we target the virus with is the RNA. So that means we already do an amplification job. How does that work? Well, every cell in our body has DNA, and it encodes different types of RNA. And Da Vinci said that it should be simplified, but I'm not even trying to simplify it. The years are gone when my students would raise their hand and say, excuse me, what is RNA? Today you find RNA everywhere in the newspaper. So this is a great progress in my point of view. Meaning students from the lab with a clinician who treats coronavirus patients, we looked at the genes that are affected, and what we found was that many different tissues could be affected. Look at this. These are the RNAs that are expressed, and here are the genes that we identified in that study. It was really nice that one of these genes is called dancer. So we named the paper after this dance, but I wouldn't play with this dancer. It's not a safe dance. Another point that we need to remember is that the world has changed. In 1950, when the polio pandemic spread, it affected mainly children, but children were the main part of the population. Today, the coronavirus affects adults and aged patients, who are a great part of today's population. And this change will probably extend because life expectancy keeps getting longer and longer. So who should be thanked for that? To begin with, let me say that this is a detective story. The corona is a spy who came in from the cold, as we saw in Dana's movie. And it's a good point to remember John le Carré, whose books I admire. We also need to thank our collaborators. And many years ago, Efrat Levi-Lahad, who is a member of our genetics department, told me that when she published her important paper in Science, she took her son from kindergarten and the radio spoke about Dr. Levi-Lahad's discoveries. she with her collaborators. So her son said, "Mommy, the collaborators are us, right?" And I couldn't agree more with that statement. So here is my youngest granddaughter. That's my favorite collaborator. But of course, well, who we need to thank are the patient volunteers that provide samples, the collaborators, basic researchers and clinicians, the foundations that support our research, the Friends of Hebrew University who helps us can maintain this study. What we have found in that study that I talked about is that the virus may also affect memory, cognition, and the capacity to focus, which is important to know that are also features that are affected by this infection. And I told you about differences between men and women, changes in the population, changes with age, and the transfer from DNA to RNA to protein, which enables the pyramid of vaccination that we are all benefited from. And I need to thank you very much for listening.
Thank you so much, Hermona. Thank you for this, for these foils. And I will start now with questions that we have received in the past several days and we're receiving right now. Hermona, if you can please end the share. Thank you. So I will start with the first question. Perhaps I'll direct it to the real physician we have here in the room, to Dana. Dana, please unmute yourself. What is, in your eyes, the significance of the fast approval process of this, what seems to be like a semi-approval? Is it real? Is it not? What should we make out of it, we, the layman, in terms of the fast approval process? Again, especially the Pfizer and Moderna.
Okay, thank you for this important question. I would like to tell you that I am a member of the Israeli ACIP, the Advisory Committee for Vaccines and Infectious Diseases. So we have these considerations. Now, this is a relatively fast approval. There is an emergency approval, and then there is a constant approval, but there was no cutting corners here. This is a very important point to emphasize. What made it possible is, first, the very, very novel and fast production technology of the mRNA. We never faced it before in vaccines, in infectious disease vaccines. Just for the sake of comparison, you have to take into account that to prepare the yearly influenza vaccine, it takes half a year, okay? Because we prepare it in eggs or in cells. But here is a very fast production technology. So that's first thing. Secondly, which allowed also to perform or to conduct the phases, the clinical phases in parallel. So there was a toxicology phase, the safety phase, and then the efficacy phase because of the fast production and the tremendous financial investment, they could be conducted in parallel. And then finally, what came into our rescue in terms of development of vaccine was the ongoing circulation of the virus. It was very easy to recruit the groups that Amos, that Professor Panet mentioned, the placebo versus the ones that got the vaccine. And then it was easy to follow the efficacy vaccine because we had a virus circulating, actively circulating. Sometimes you have to wait years before you can recruit. So enough patients with infection and without infection. So I don't think there was a cutting corner here. And actually just today in the Israeli committee, we had the discussion and finally we approved the Moderna vaccine. We still have to get some more information, but the information is mainly technical, production, stability, monitoring of the different batches of the vaccine, but it's purely technical,
I think. So Dana, let me challenge you briefly. From the statistics we see, I hear at least, that about a third of the American medical professionals are yet hesitant to take the mRNA-based vaccines. I don't believe these are the numbers in Hadassah, right? is this justified in your eyes, the fact that a third of medical professionals will not take this vaccine?
No, not at all. I think it's a fear from the new, it's a fear from the unknown. But this looks like a very safe vaccine. Actually, I think in Israel, we are pioneering it. As Mona mentioned, more than a million individuals already received the vaccine in Israel in a very, I mean, in an amazing way, in an amazing vaccination program, very fast and very efficient. Most of them are 60 years and older. And we do see some adverse effects, but very minor so far, nothing, no anaphylaxis, no deaths. There was some interesting side effects that we may want to talk about later, but very, 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 very few.
Okay.
So I think, and in Israel, we expected some hesitancy, but we see the opposite.
Yeah. Yeah. So let me take it to a little more challenging question. This one to Amos and Mona. Reading the news, we see this major, experiment taking place in the UK these days, given the grave situation there, which is the single shot, policy. In other words, even though the current course recommended by both the manufacturers and the regulators is a two-shot, course. Britain has decided, I hear also Germany is considering it, to providing only the first dose to as many people as possible, and hopefully maybe within 90 days or so, providing the second shot. Is this, in your opinion, worth taking? Amos, if you want, please, to respond.
Well, it's a risk, no doubt about it. However, each country should decide to itself. In an emergency case, I don't see much of a problem to delay the second shot, the second vaccination, because we know that the 21 day of Pfizer or 28 day of Moderna, these are not written in the Bible. So we can delay the second shot. By how much, I cannot tell you, but for another month, I'm pretty sure that it's safe. And we know from the studies that I showed you before, that after the first vaccination, after 14 days from the first vaccination, very few people came with a disease. Very few people reported that they are sick, and none was seriously sick. So they didn't have to hospitalize any of the people who reported with a disease. So of course, for countries which can afford to give two vaccinations, exactly as a company advised, is much better. However, I cannot criticize Britain in the face of such a horrible epidemic to consider it. Whether they will do it eventually or not, I don't know. But I don't think that it will affect much the efficacy of the vaccination.
Okay, thank you, Mona. Are you?
Maybe Mona.
Mona, do you agree?
I'm not a clinician, but I believe in clinical trials. The trial was done in a certain way, and following that protocol will ensure good results. It was not tested the other way. That's my concern. So I would go for following the protocol that had been established, tested, and approved by those committees, just like the one that Dana described. Those committees exist in every country. And there are examples of previous medications that were used without following the protocol, and that came up with the very unfortunate results. So I wouldn't take the risk.
Okay.
Can I also add a small point to support? First of all, I support Mona's notion. And then I would like to raise, and I'm curious what you would say about it, Amos, from a virological point of view. You know, one shot raises a certain level of antibodies. which is not as high as the second shot. So you will leave many people with a low antibody level. Now, this is a very good condition to develop mutants, viral mutations, because then what you will have is low level of antibodies versus ongoing transmission of viruses. And I think I'm concerned that it may help develop more viral mutants that may be resistant to the vaccine. So I am in favor of giving the booster shot. We can delay it in 1 week or two. I mean, that is not the issue, but not more than this.
Amos, any return comments?
Well, I agree both with Mona and with Dana. It's, you know, countries which can afford to give the two vaccines, of course, it's more efficient and it's better. However, if people are dying and there is hospitals are full, I mean, it's a different type of decisions. Now it's a, you know, policymakers should make a very tough decision. And I don't envy them for this decision. But if I would have to decide, viewing the situation in England, I would go for at least 2 months delay, not more. I wouldn't say I would wait for 6 months. But I've worked a lot on vaccines at the Vaccine Research Center at the NIH. And we have delayed second vaccination, not in human, in mice, I should say, and it still works. So the first memory is good enough to last for more than a month or 2 months. I want to add one more point, which may be not related to this. We speak about the Pfizer vaccine and the Moderna vaccine, but we should give credit to the people who really developed the technology. These are not the Pfizer and the Moderna scientists. The Pfizer bought a development from a small German company, a small biotech company, and they have done the initial discovery. Moderna, Pfizer has developed it and optimized all the steps in a clinical study. And the Moderna vaccine has been licensed from the NIH, from the National Institute of Health, where basic scientists have worked for many years on the development of DNA vaccines, RNA vaccines. So all of these are credit to basic scientists. And it should be stressed because we don't hear about them now. We hear only about the two companies, Moderna and Pfizer.
Yeah. Yeah, thank you, Amos. I agree, and we are the Hebrew University, right? That's what we do. A question to Mona, you know, that circulates here. Here's the question, you know, how is the RNA or mRNA extinguished? Or maybe in other words, you know, let's say we get the Pfizer shot. So now to the rest of our lives, we'll have this mRNA circulating in our body. How does it work? Please, Mona.
So RNA gets degraded. There are proteins in each of our cells. Their job is to destroy RNA. RNA is a commodity that gets produced and gets destroyed routinely. And I'm aware of the fake news messages on WhatsApp that were brought to my attention by several people already, that the government implants something in our blood. This is nonsense. It's fake news at its worst phase. And the injection goes away. It leaves the job to be done by us. The RNA gets translated and gets destroyed. The protein is recognized by our immune cells. We are the ones who produce the protection, and the immunization just triggers it.
Okay, thank you. A question, you know, from the audience and perhaps to our clinician here. There are concerns, they may be fake, they may be not, you'll soon tell us, about the vaccines potentially harming fertility to young adults, men and women. Is there a basis for this fear of, you know, fertility being affected by these vaccines?
No, I am not familiar with any basis for these fake news. I mean, there is some, I mean, there was some comparison with a protein that exists in cells of the placenta, but it's not based on any scientific evidence, scientific okay. or clinical evidence.
In one more question, Dana, if we're up to this, do you believe, with COVID-19, it's not going to go away probably in the next couple of months. Will the COVID-19 injection or vaccination become an annual rite? In other words, are we expected every year to go to the Jerusalem Sports Arena like Mona and get our yearly or twice yearly, I don't know, COVID injection?
Well, I am not in a position to predict the future, but there is a possibility. I can foresee a possibility that this will be the case. First of all, the virus already has shown us that it mutates, not as fast or as much as the influenza virus, by the way. It has a proofreading capacity, but it's capable of mutation. And then we might have to adapt the vaccine to the circulating mutants. And this is going to be quite easy in the case of the mRNA vaccine. This is a major advantage of the mRNA vaccine. It won't take half a year to establish or to produce such a vaccine. So that's one thing. Secondly, we don't know how long the antibodies or the protection will last. We don't know even how long it lasts after natural infection. So we don't know how long it lasts after vaccination. So we have to learn. We have to really, I mean, this is what the Hebrew University is for. We have to learn how long the antibodies stay, what's the protection, what's the correlates of protection. So, well, I think you may be right, but I'm not sure.
Okay. It may be a question to Amos. So we talk about, you know, AstraZeneca, and, you know, we never spoke about Sputnik 5 and Pfizer and Moderna and so on. The rumor is that there's an Israeli vaccine being developed these very days. If you can tell us a little bit about, you know, the novel Israeli vaccine.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, it's not a rumor. The government has instructed at the beginning of the pandemic, the Israeli Biological Institute to start developing a vaccine, and they have based their development on an attenuated virus that was engineered to carry the coronavirus protein, such that this virus now, once injected, will produce the coronavirus protein and will elicit the immunity required to against the disease. And in fact, they have done a great job. I'm in a scientific advisory board of this development. So we follow very, very closely this development. They have done all the preclinical analysis and have shown efficacy of this vaccine, then have done phase one, and now they are in the middle of phase two. They are not as advanced as some other companies like Moderna and Pfizer, because they have started later. They've started only in April to develop the vaccines. But in few months' time, hopefully, they will have phase three, the last phase of the development, and then approval of their vaccine. They are aiming to give only one shot of the vaccine. So perhaps it would be better than other vaccines where we need two shots. But we will see. They are testing both one shot vaccination and two shot vaccination like the Moderna and Pfizer vaccine. And hopefully next year when we'll need vaccine, we'll have a vaccine which is blue and white vaccine made in Israel.
Okay. A question to you, Mona. Oh, sorry, Mona, you wanted to say something?
I wanted to add something to what Amos and Dana said. The revolution of development of RNA vaccines goes beyond this particular pandemic, because the next virus that will come from somewhere will know how to do it. We can print the protein we target and develop a vaccine much faster than was ever possible for humanity. And I already read a book that said humanity develops in jumps after wars, after pandemics, after major catastrophes, always comes the breakthrough. And I think it's a nice thought to cling to.
And I believe, Mona, that the next influenza vaccine that we will get, not just pandemic, the yearly influenza vaccine will be an mRNA vaccine.
So here's the question, you know, Mona, to you, you know, as our mRNA expert here, you know, there is this very strange feature of the Pfizer that it has to come in extreme cold, you know, minus 80 or 85 degrees centigrade, also Moderna minus 20. What is the reason for this? Why do we need these extraordinary storage requirements?
Well, RNA is a fragile animal. You need to keep it very cold so that it won't disintegrate. And that also answers the other question. Does the immunization get into our genome? It can't, because the RNA gets degraded. Once it's out of the freezing cold temperature, and it's injected, it will do its job, it will translate into protein and vanish. It won't get into our genome, it will just let us do the job of getting immunized.
Can I add one point? We have to remember that the RNA vaccines are encapsulated by a membrane, a lipid membrane, which kind of keeps the RNA inside what we call in a scientific language a liposome. So this liposome is built of fatty acids, and it's very sensitive also to temperature. So we have to keep the RNA, which is unstable, as Mona said, and we also have to keep the envelope, envelope of the RNA such that it will enter into cells. Without this envelope, the RNA will have problems enter into our muscle cells. So that's two components of the vaccine, of the vaccines.
So maybe, you know, also a practical question, maybe to you, Dana, you know, sitting on the Israeli approval board, why is it that the dosage of the Moderna is about three times the dosage of Pfizer? I mean, do they need to inject us with more mRNA particles? What is the reason for this?
Actually, that's a good question. We discussed it today, and I don't think we have a clear answer. Apparently, in the first phase of experiments, first phase of the trial, we noticed that Moderna really jumped very quickly by the doses of the RNA. We don't have a clear explanation. Well, the RNA is of different chemistry, but we don't have a clear explanation why they needed a much higher dose, like three times higher doses. That's a good question. We discussed it, and we don't have a good answer for you.
I see.
Amos, okay. Do you have any?
No. They tried different doses in the phase one and phase two. And they decide on 100, but in fact, Pfizer achieved the same type of protection with only 30 micrograms.
Yes, we wondered what
difference in the RNA, minute differences in the RNA of the two companies. So this may also affect the
there is also difference in the liposomal part, so it may also affect the immunity, but I mean, these are assumptions.
Yeah. You know, it is, you know, we head towards closing, and we'll still answer a number of questions. And maybe continuing, you know, a note, Amos, you brought up. You know, in the Hebrew University, most, not all, of what we're engaged in is basic science. And here, you know, I have these, you know, you three great scientists. You've spent careers really studying and analyzing and publishing. And here, you know, the big heroes of the day are these big pharmaceutical companies, you know, saving humanity, so to say. Where, how do you see the role of the basic science? You know, behind all this, is someone stealing your thunder? You know, is it these companies that suddenly they get the glory and our poor scientists, you know, stay in the lab? Do we not do our job maybe properly? How do you see this tension? And I would say the importance of the basic science.
Well, you know, there would be no pharmaceutical companies without basic science. A messenger RNA has not been invented by pharmaceutical companies. It was invented in Cambridge by scientists who study basic research. So this is the foundation of all development, all drugs, not only drugs. You know, if you look at a CT or MRI or any development, medical development, it started at the academia. So without academia, there is nothing. And in fact, at the Hebrew University, there is a company, Yisum, who licensed the development of the scientists, of the researchers at the Hebrew University. They license it to companies and also encourage scientists at the university to develop startups, to start a biotech, small biotech companies, and to get out and develop the product into a clinical use. So there is a very tight correlation between the two, and they cannot go one without the other. Academia also cannot go all the way to develop the drug, to do phase three studies on 40,000 people. It requires a lot of administration, a lot of arrangements. Only companies can do it.
Yeah. Mona, how do you see it? Are you frustrated? Someone is stealing your thunder?
No, I've been coming to Yisum for years saying we have a new RNA drug. And they would say, you are preceding your time. There is no RNA drug. Now they won't be able to say that anymore. So that gives me a piece of pleasure. But I think there are three arms of heroes here. There are the basic scientists who discovered the concept. There are the companies that use those concepts to break through into a new technology. And there is the clinical arm and the HMOs and the system of public medicine, without which we couldn't even test it. So I think that the collaboration between these three arms is the real hero in this story. And I can only hope that it will continue this way.
Yeah. Dana, your perspective?
Yes, I fully agree. I actually enjoy, and I think the collaboration between me as a clinician based, as a clinician scientist, and the companies is really productive. Because, for example, we've recently, together with Amos, we've recently established a very unique system to study viruses. It's a unique ex vivo system of human target tissues that we use to study viruses, including influenza and including the newly emerging SARS-CoV-2. And we have been approached by several small and even big drug companies and vaccine companies to study their drugs, newly developed drugs or antibodies in these human surrogate model that we have developed. And as Amos and mentioned, that we also start developing drugs, we go to agencies like Yisum or Hadasit to, and we just start, and then companies have to take it from there.
Yeah. Okay. So you know, our time is almost up. Are there any finishing comments, you know, from Amos or Mona or Dana that you want to add for our session? Amos, any closing comments?
As Dana said, pandemics will come, definitely. It's just a question when. So we have to develop more efforts to study viruses, not only human viruses, but viruses in nature, animal viruses, because we know for sure that the new viruses will come to us from animals. And very little money has been spent so far on research of animal viruses. And I hope now that more work will be done on this, in this direction.
Okay. Thank you. Mona, closing comments.
Well, I'm really impressed by the number of people who probably hear and read and see a lot about this story and came up to view and listen to us. I think we all need to thank our followers. The Hebrew University would not be what it is without the friends. And we are here. If anyone has a pressing question that we didn't answer, send an email. I always answer my emails. Actually, my sons say that if I don't answer an email for 6 hours, that means that I'm on transatlantic flight. But right now, I'm not going anywhere. So feel free to send emails.
Thank you, Mona. Dana, closing comments?
Yes, I would like to mention the partnership of the Hebrew University and the Hadassah Medical Center. And I think this joint hospital-university effort is likely to enhance translational virology research and establish the basis for future collaborations using models and clinical samples, which we have plenty of, with continued sharing of infrastructure and knowledge, like we proved that we are able to do.
Thank you. Thank you. So I really want to conclude this session by thanking our wonderful panelists, you know, Dana, Mona, and Amos, by thanking the external relationship team that is with us, that set up and really made all of this possible. And perhaps, you know, the biggest thanks is to our friends globally. It was great to have 260 and 270 people here. We miss you all. We really hope that these vaccines are the beginning of the end, not the end of the beginning. I really hope so. And that may we all, you know, get together, meet in person, and resume normal life. And beyond that, you know, listening to our panelists here today, be better prepared for the future, for the things that will come. And I really hope that mankind, with the help of science, has learned a lot from these very hard days. So thank you, everybody. Have a good day, a good evening, and we will meet you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.